The codes I came across were numerous. I would like to start by classifying them into natural codes and man-made codes. In natural codes, there is great diversity. This is a road that connects Bhuj to Banni. But to go to villages, you have to leave the main road and go 3 kilometers on either side of this tar road, where Banni begins to look like this. It is very easy to get lost, especially for a new person. This is where visual codes, in specific, vegetation as a code comes in handy. This is Gando Bawal, that is Prosopis juliflora. This is Desi Bawal, that is the native species of babool. And this is a medicinal plant care. Banni being a mudflat, you can see all the way up to the horizon. Suppose you get lost in the desert, you just have to find your way to the nearest thicket of Desi Bawal trees to find yourself at a village. Animals in Banni graze freely without supervision. So animal droppings become an indication to the grazing paths animals have taken on a particular day. Natural codes of animal health. Perfect Banni buffalo, the horns should be tightly coiled in concentric spiral, should have thin skin, firm udders and teats, prominent milk vein, should be smaller in the front and larger at the back, a pear shape of sorts. This shape is especially suitable for hassle-free deliveries of children. Body height should be proportional to body length and weight. Feet shouldn't be too long or too short. Similarly, there are codes of good health for camels. The hump should be slim and heightened, small chest pad, head and mouth raised upward and looking forward, erect ears, chavro color, that is, blackish brown. In case of males, an uplifted scrotum, and in case of females, a prominent milk vein. Next, we come to the man-made codes of Banni. First up, audio codes. The azan heard from the mosque. In the pre-cell phone or wristwatch days, an azan that takes place 5 times a day was a good clue of keeping time. Coming next, the copper bells. Dominant female of any herd of animals wears the copper bell around her neck. Rest of the livestock follows this sound boundary and grazes within the hearing distance of it. The morchang. Herders and shepherds play morchang. This music entertains the shepherd and creates an audio boundary for the livestock to graze within. Olfactory code. Charcoal smoke. The whiff of charcoal smoke is another way for a lost person in Banni to find his or her way back to the nearest village. Animal husbandry in Banni follows interesting patterns. Livestock is not tied up in enclosures. It openly grazes during the night and returns home twice a day to the owner's place at the time of milking and consuming livestock feed. Since livestock grazes unsupervised, an ownership identification system had to be devised. Man-made codes of animal husbandry in Banni, codes of ownership. Brand marks, tears and slits. If you look at the cow, you will see a tear or a slit made on the upper part of the ear. This is mark that this animal belongs to the Hale Potra clan. Yet another clan, the Raisi Potras, have a tear or a slit at the bottom of the ear in their animal. Man-made codes in animal husbandry, visual codes, heat and acid, branding symbols. These symbols of ownership go way back. The earliest method of adding one symbol onto the animal was branding the animal using iron rods and heat. Here, you see the mark of a spectacle put on a buffalo that belongs to the Jat clan. Branding with acid can be divided into two parts, branding symbols and branding initials or the owner's name. These iron rods are locally called numbers. An iron rod is taken, dipped into acid, and then a mark is made on the animal's body. Here's a case of brand marks and battery powder ointment. In some villages, they have an interesting method of treating the wounds that this scarring due to acid causes. Crows pick at this wound. Livestock keepers prevent this from happening by packing this wound using the dark powder that one finds in the used battery cells and adding mustard oil to it. This is kind of harmful as the battery powder contains many chemicals which may fall into milk while milking the livestock. A non-invasive method of branding animals is adding colors to their bodies. This method is used mostly with sheep and goat. Accessories is mostly used in case of cows. Man-made codes of animal decoration of Banni. Applying ghee to an animal indicates that the animal is participating in a competition of health and beauty or is being decorated prior to a sale. The marks on camel you see are for decoration and not necessarily for identification. Tail and wool cuts are seen as a form of decoration mostly in camels. Man-made codes of medical history. A cross sign brand mark on the left rear of an animal indicates that this animal was treated for the disease of the gallbladder. Similarly, depending on which part of the body the animal is branded using a cross, one can conclude whether the animal suffers from other ailments also. Man-made codes of animal husbandry-based livelihoods in Banni. Milk flags. As you pass on the tar road that connects Bhuj to Banni, one will see these flags on either side. This is a code for milk vans to stop and collect milk. The code of claim dung. Women and children collect dung from around the villages and sell it to farmers in other parts of Kutch. A code that this dung has already been claimed by a family is when a stick is stuck into it and others cannot collect it. Codes of animal trade. Animal buying and selling. To negotiate a price for the animal in question without others in the vicinity finding out about it, the buyer and the animal owner cover their hands with a handkerchief or a shawl and negotiate under it in a coded manner. If only one finger is pressed for a prolonged time, then it stands for 1 lakh rupees. If multiple fingers except the thumb are pressed together for a long time, then each finger will stand for 10,000 rupees. Here, you see a code for 40,000 rupees since four fingers are being simultaneously pressed. When only a thumb is pressed, it means 5,000 rupees. When the whole palm, including the thumb and four fingers, are pressed together for a prolonged time, it indicates 50,000 rupees. There are personal codes in Banni. Codes of religion. People add religious symbols to their assets, that is, vehicles, to indicate the religion of the owner. Yet another personal code is the code of clan or caste as seen on the dresses. Here, you see the garb of a Jat woman. This is a Jat house. Here's the embroidery of a woman belonging to the Haliputra clan. And this is the Haliputra kitchen. The room on your left is the kitchen. The house, the circular structure on the right, is the bhunga that acts as a drawing room as well as a bedroom. Here, you see a woman belonging to the Jat clan, the one with a big nose ring, while the other woman belongs to the Chher community. Here you see Harijan women. This is just to say that a clan or a community can be easily identified depending on their costume or the embroidery style. I continued to code hunt in Banni. Although I was on a lookout for non-verbal codes of communication in Banni, I chanced upon two interesting verbal codes as well. Animal names as a code. Each family has a herd size of about 100 to 300 animals. And when they come back to the owner's house for getting milk and for receiving their feed, it is difficult to feed so many animals at once. Hence, livestock keepers have given a unique name to each and every animal. And over a period of time, the animals too have gotten used to being called by a particular name. So when a livestock keeper calls out a name, only that particular animal will emerge from the group. Now that's a very interesting verbal code. The second verbal code, however, is unfortunate. Many a times due to ill health of animals or due to lack of food and water, they do not yield milk. In such times, livestock keepers use malpractices such as administering synthetic doses of the hormone called oxytocin, which has been banned by the government. Oxytocin is easily available locally at Banni in small shop and general stores. Ironically, if you remember, the first assignment I was given in Banni was design of labels for a box of penda, sweet made out of saturating milk and sugar. At the very end of this journey, I realized when a livestock keeper goes to a local shop asking for a penda box, he's handed a box of oxytocin syringes. From designing label for a penda box to discovering the ugly side of traditional livelihoods, life suddenly seems to have come full circle. As a visual communicator, there are some lessons to be taken away. First of all, design education could take place outside the classroom. Design education could focus on addressing wicked problems. In Banni's context, it would mean interventions like anti-oxytocin advocacy, a redesign of ownership identity codes for livestock to prevent scarring them with heat or acid. One could also work on communication design interventions that create awareness about women's reproductive health and hygiene. Can there be a communication design curriculum which will equip individuals with methods they can use in the field, which will instill in individuals empathy and dignity for those around them? Perhaps this is a new code of thought and conduct for a visual communication student that needs to be built into the future curriculum. Thank you for listening to this presentation.